All right, Thrive Nation, on today's edition of the Thrive Time Show, we're going to be talking about how to choose your customer and how to compete against massive digital giants. Aaron, why would any small business owner possibly want to learn how to compete against massive companies?
Well, because otherwise you're going to be crushed. You got to find your niche in order to get rich. You got to slide in there in the middle or on around the edges and not get crushed by the big guys.
Aaron, but what if our listeners want to be crushed and they want to make new wine?
Oh, then I guess they
so the spiritual way. I guess on a spiritual level, we do want to be crushed. We want to make new wine, right?
That's true.
But in the business game, you probably don't want to be crushed because
no, that's different.
You'll be out of money, and then you'll be living in a van down by the river.
Yeah, and probably drinking a lot of wine.
Well, I see what you did there. Full circle.
Oh,
all this and more today on today's edition of the Thrive Time Show on your radio and podcast download as we interview the MIT professor and author, Jonathan Burns.
Some shows don't need a celebrity narrator to introduce the show, but this show does. Two men, eight kids, co-created by two different women, 13 multi-million dollar businesses. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Thrive Time Show.
Now, 3, 2, 1, here we go!
We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, and we'll show you how to get here. We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, now we're here.
Yes, 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 and yes! Dr. Z, it is always ecstasy when you are next to me.
Right back at ye.
And one thing that you've been able to do, sir, is you've been able to scale up your optometry clinic into the state's largest and most successful optometry clinic. You've been able to scale up your auto auction into the state's largest and most successful auto auction. Z, you've been able to scale up multiple businesses.
By the way, we're celebrating our 8-year anniversary at the auto auction.
8th year?
This Friday. So we have a big party sale, and it's going to be crazy.
Well, on today's show, we are interviewing an expert on how to scale things up.
Cool.
Jonathan, welcome on to the Thrive Time Show. How are you, sir?
I'm doing great. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Hey, your resume speaks for itself. However, a lot of our listeners listen to this on audio only, and I don't want to fail to mention anything about your career up to now. Can you give our listeners just a little bit of a sneak peek into your career previous to this interview?
Sure.
And that way people know just a little bit about your background.
Happy to. I have a doctorate from Harvard Business School, an MBA from Columbia, and I have been teaching at MIT for the past 31 years. I also have a software company called ProfitIsle, ProfitIsle. We do profit analytics. I wrote a book on that, co-wrote it with my colleague John Wass, called Choose Your Customer, How to Compete with Amazon and Thrive. And what else? I'm grading papers as we speak.
Grading papers.
Wow, this guy is a smart guy. Now, when you're at MIT, do you ever dress up like a janitor and go down the hallways and solve complex math problems on the boards? Do you ever do that?
I imagine that. Excuse me. I imagine that would make a pretty good movie.
Oh, I'm just kind of kicking around. I don't know.
Sorry.
No problem. Apologies. Now, so let's talk about where you see a lot of people getting it wrong as it relates to trying to compete with their small business. So a lot of people have a small business and they're going head to head with a major company. You mentioned competing with Amazon or maybe a big box retailer or somebody who's clearly a Goliath in their industry. Where do you see a lot of small business owners getting it wrong?
Well, it's exactly what you said. They try to compete with Amazon and the others. You know, it's like the Boston Red Sox. I do apologize.
No problem.
It's like the Boston. It's like the Patriots playing Manchester United. It really depends on what you're playing. So the key for smallish customers, or small companies, is not to go head to head with Amazon. You'll never win. And in fact, the ironic thing is that Amazon won by taking customers that nobody wanted. And basically, Amazon and the other digital giants do one thing and one thing only, and they do it unbelievably well. They do arm's length services to small customers. And for most companies, up until about 15 years ago, that was a segment that they couldn't deal with, because there were thousands and thousands of small customers. They didn't know anything about them. What Amazon did, and the other digital giants, is that they were able to use the internet to probe those customers and profile them. And then they made a science out of serving them. And God help a small company that goes head to head with that. What that does do, which is really, really critical, is it leaves a huge open playing field for the higher service relationships with companies. You'll never find Amazon dealing with the factory floor. You never find Amazon in a hospital. Basically, it's internet services to small customers. And that leaves an enormous and very, very lucrative open playing field, but it's a different way to do business. And that's what the book is about.
So, again, if people want to buy your book, where's the best place for them to find the book?
They can just pre-order it on Amazon. Or we have a book website called ChooseYourCustomer.com.
ChooseYourCustomer.com.
You can click on pre-order. Also, read a couple of chapters.
So, if people go to ChooseYourCustomer.com, again, you know how it is. I mean, there's so many books out there that are available. There seems like there's a new business book, a can't-miss business book that comes out every day. And I really do believe that your book has the power to completely transform somebody's business. And I don't want to give away the entire book. So if it's okay, I'd like to tap into your wisdom on maybe four or five key points in the book.
Absolutely.
And then you can hang up on me, and we'll just, that way, you hang up before we unveil all the moves.
Don't irritate him before he answers the questions like you are off to do.
Okay, so here we go. So this first big idea I wanted to tap into in the book was disrupt the market and wipe out the competition. What does that mean,
sir?
It's
like a nuclear bomb.
Basically, do something that's unique that only you can do, where you've got a defensible market segment and you can grow and be the best at that. If you try to compete with people who are the best at other things, you're going to get killed. And that's the basic reason why so many companies have gone bankrupt in the past year or two.
Now, you talk in your book about designing a business around your lifestyle. And Aaron, you and I were talking about this. As Shaw Homes has grown, ironically, Jonathan, Shaw Homes is Oklahoma's largest home building company. And Aaron Antis runs that company. And as you guys have grown, Aaron, from $24 million to $150-plus million, you're working less than you were when it was at $24 million. I want to get your take on this, Aaron, then I want to go back to Jonathan here. How have you helped to design the business, Aaron, over at Shaw Homes around your lifestyle?
Well, I would say it's just, you know, figuring out ways to scale things that used to need my 100% involvement and creating systems and processes, lots of checklists. The other day, James was getting ready to close on a home, and so he said, "Do you have any kind of a checklist I could go through of all the things I should look at in the home before I go move into the home?" And I gave you a 10-page checklist, about 300 items to go through that he can look through for his home, which is something we do on every single home before we close. But there's a person who does that, so we're sort of quality controlling our own home before the customer does that. And so it's just putting those processes into place along the way as we build the home in every aspect of it from beginning to end to make sure that it's done efficiently.
So, Jonathan, can you kind of coach our listeners here, our business-owning listeners out there? What is the best way to design a business around their lifestyle?
Well, the question, I think, is whether you design it around your own lifestyle or your customer's lifestyle. Mm. And the biggest opportunities come from spending time directly in your customers, which I call a showcase project, understanding what they do well, what they don't do well, where they need help. And I can give you a very specific example. A number of years ago, I worked with a company called Baxter, a huge healthcare company, and they were in trouble. They had competition all over the place. So we had to figure out what to do. And what we did is we went inside the hospitals because we had been delivering products to the doc. And we actually followed the products through the hospital all the way to the patient's arm. So if the cost of a liter of IV solution was a dollar at the doc, the landed cost in a patient's arm was around $7. And of that $6 increment, $3 were addressable, but nobody had ever bothered to look. So that's an example. And we developed a business now called Vendor Managed Inventory. That's a staple in supply chain where companies manage the supply chain inside their customers. Second example, there's a company called Nalco, N-A-L-C-O. They're out of the Chicago area. They do chemicals for water treatment systems. And they decided that they would put wireless sensors in the customer's tanks so that they could be more efficient in delivery. What they discovered when they spent some time inside their customers, not interviewing them, but watching what they were doing, they found that a major water treatment system couldn't tell until a month later if it was running efficiently. But Nalco's engineers said, well, we can look every day at the rate of drawdown of the chemicals and tell the customer whether they're efficient or not. And all of a sudden, if the cost of a year of chemicals for the Chicago water treatment system is $1 million, the cost of being inefficient is $40 million. And all of a sudden, it was a no-brainer, because what they did is, I'd call it, they expanded the boundaries of their business to include the customer. And that's the way you, and you don't see Amazon doing that. I mean, they do it digitally with their question and answer and their recommendations, but you don't see them going inside customers and actually operating. And I think that that's where the enormous opportunity is today.
If it's okay with you, I would like to potentially offend today's guest. And if you give me permission.
It's about time. Well, it's about time. I'm surprised you waited this long.
It's more on you than it's on me.
Okay. I'll take the
I taught this morning at MIT, so I'm used to it.
Okay. So Jonathan, with all due respect, once you say that, we talked about this before.
He shouldn't hang up on you. He shouldn't.
Okay. So a lot of people are out there trying to pronounce your last name. Oh. And there's a lot of controversy on the internet. They're saying, how do we say Jonathan's last name properly? And so, Jonathan, if you could educate us, our listeners, on how to properly pronounce your last name, we will practice right here on the air.
Well, just remember it this way. Fire burns. Jonathan burns as well.
Oh.
Well,
that was easier than I thought it was going to be.
Nice and simple.
Yeah. Z, are you okay? You want to try it? Burns.
I think it's too challenging. I can't.
Okay.
Is it a silent B? I don't know. Is it yearns? I think it was yearns.
And actually at MIT, because we have so many students from all over the world, it really is an art to try to figure out how to pronounce all the names. And I do love my students. But several years ago, I had a Thai student named Pakawako Kudatep.
What?
Pakawako Kudatep. She actually runs Amazon in Asia right now.
Wow.
And, you know, I practiced and practiced before class so that I could greet her by name, which is what I like to do with my students. And I got in and I said, Pakawako Kudatep. And she said, just call me Thai.
Oh.
But I never forgot it.
Pakawako
Kudatep.
Kudatep.
That's a Thai name.
Pakawako.
And it stands for
Kudatep.
My tie's a little rusty, but I think that translates over to Betty, if I'm not mistaken. I think that's. I mean, I'm a little rusty on my
tie.
Seven
syllables in that name.
It's actually Fran, is what it is.
Is it Fran?
Okay, now Jonathan, in your book, you talk about managing difficult relationships. Now, everybody out there listening, we all have some customers, Z, where you just say, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. Z, we've all had a customer where we say, it's just not worth it. Jonathan Burns, walk us through, sir. What does your book tell listeners about managing difficult relationships in the game of business?
Okay, you have to step back. In any company, there are three segments of business. They have high profit customers, which we call profit peaks.
Love them.
They have low profit customers that are big, called profit drains. That's probably what you're talking about. And then half their customers do nothing. They're profit deserts. So for the profit drains, 9 times out of 10, the problem is not the price. It's that the cost of operations is too high. So things like they're ordering every day when they should order once or twice a week. By the way, that's why most distributors of beer are losing a fortune on craft beer, because people are ordering every day instead of once a week. And that sounds trivial, but it'll flip a huge account from a big loss to a big profit. And interestingly, it's a win for the customer as well as the supplier, because every time you ship, they've got to receive, they have to put it away and all the rest of it. So what we recommend, what I recommend in the book, is that you have a multi-capability team for your profit peaks, because the way you make the most money is by doubling them. It's really that simple. And you do that through the things that I described with Baxter and Nalco, making them much more profitable. For your drains, you need a different type of multi-capability team, like a bank's workout team for problem loans, where they go in and they know exactly why they're losing money, and they know exactly what to fix and exactly how much it's worth to the customer. And I said the customer, not the supplier. Because if you really want to win in business, it's all about the customer all the time. And then with the deserts, the key is to use your digital transformation to get the cost to serve down through portals and menus and a variety of things like that.
Clay, we have, for our drains, we have a committee. It's headed by a guy by the name of Rocco, and he goes out and visits folks.
For your drains?
For my drains.
What are you talking about?
For our customers that we're losing money on. Rocco goes and visits them.
It's very effective.
It's very, very effective.
Oh.
You never, ever, ever want to get rid of customers. But the one thing you don't want to do above everything else, which I hope your listeners will remember, the most important thing not to do is to spend all your resources trying to hold on to small customers that Amazon is going to eat up. And that's what most people do, because they're measured only on revenue and not on profit.
That's a good word.
Now, I want to ask you this question here, and then we're transitioning right now into the rapid fire portion.
We're going
to
lightning round already?
It's going to be fast.
Oh my gosh.
Fast and furious here.
Oh no.
Again, okay. Somebody out there has a trigger finger. They want to buy your book right now on Amazon. But Aaron, you know this, they're thinking about buying something else.
Right.
They're going, if I buy the book, I can't spend $25 on the new, Chinese finger locks they were wanting.
Oh, yeah.
Or the off-brand Crocs they were wanting to get.
Those are so good, though.
Or the old DVD. A lot of people are binge buying DVDs right now because they're on sale.
$5 a piece.
Forgetting that they actually don't have a DVD player. So, Jonathan, you have a lot of competition here. Why should everybody pick up a copy of your book?
Because if they don't pick up a copy of my book, they're probably going to buy a book that says something, that the title something like this: Here's Amazon's Secret to Success, and you can do it too.
Okay.
Not only will they lose the $25, they'll lose all the rest of their money trying to do that forever, because you'll never compete head on with Amazon unless you're Target or Walmart and maybe Facebook or Google.
Z, you can one up me now, my friend. Rapid fire.
I wasn't sure where he was going to go. I thought I was going to say, if they don't buy my book, they can get a lot of those Chinese finger locks. But I guess if they're not going to buy your book, they'll probably buy
this just
book.
In.
Everybody should get your book and read it before they start their business, if they haven't already started it. The concepts are mind-blowing, and that is, everybody thinks, business is war, and people that are entrepreneurs are most of the successful ones are ready for a battle, but you got to pick your battles, and you got to know.
You have to pick your battle where your competition is weak.
Right. I mean, David did kill Goliath, but that doesn't happen every day, I mean, pick up a river.
The ironic thing is that Amazon got to be Amazon because it went after customers that nobody else wanted. They stuck with their knitting. They did that and only that.
Right.
And that left a wide open playing field, but nobody could win on Amazon's turf.
Yeah.
So you have to figure out your turf really carefully. And the book describes how to do that. And then you've got to win against the other players who are after your turf. And again, we describe how to do that. It's all something that you can do, but it does take discipline not to try to hold on to every last penny that you ever had, because you have to let some customers go in order to invest in the ones that'll really take you somewhere.
And now, without any further ado, 3, 2, 1.